A very good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to TechGeek webinar series. And the topic for today's session is real-time BI. And we have with us today Deepthi Anantharaman. She is a technology evangelist at Microsoft India. In her present role, she works with developers and IT professionals across India evangelizing Microsoft technologies. Primarily, she focuses on SQL Server, business intelligence, and related technologies. She has a newfound passion for app development on Windows 8 platform. Prior to Microsoft, she has worked in different startups in the BI space in retail and banking domain. In her spare time, she likes to spend time with her family, hang around with friends, and loves to visit new places. So without any further delay, let me now hand over the session to Deepthi. Deepthi, over to you.
Right. Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to this session where we'll discuss how we can do real-time BI, especially the visualization. Right. My name is Deepthi Anantharaman. As it was mentioned, I work as a technology evangelist and have been dealing with data for about 10-11 years now. Right. Today, we have a simple three-point agenda. Why do we need to go to the cloud? We'll talk about a real scenario called change data capture. How does change data capture revolutionize the world in which we capture changes in the OLTP system and push it onto the warehouse? And we'll take a look at how the self-service BI world has revolutionized, especially on the cloud. Okay, so the question is, why should we move to the cloud? The single point agenda for any organization is to reduce its costs and to improve performance. Now, when the deployment becomes easier and faster, there's automatic reduction of the cloud, there's automatic reduction in cost which happens in the cloud. What will happen if suddenly the number of users are very many? Then there is built-in elasticity in the cloud which helps us to move forward easily. We do not have to worry about disaster recovery kind of a scenario because, again, there is high availability and triplicate copies of all data that we have on the cloud. Finally, depending on how we have made changes and implemented and moved our solution onto the cloud, there is future proofing. Sometimes the operating system can be automatically patched up. Let's say if you are using version of SQL Server 2012, if there's a new service pack released, the new service pack can be applied on the cloud without you having to do additional work. That means you can use the features that is available in the latest version without you having to do a test. All right. So these are all the generic advantages we have when we have to move to the cloud. What specifically can we get when we have to move BI to the cloud? First thing is when we have to when we are trying to work on a BI project, one of the most difficult questions that we answer as data stewards is, what is the size of the hardware? In about 3 months' time, probably, you know, the data size is going to be 10 GB, but at the end of the year, it's going to be 1 TB. So when is the right time for me to procure additional hardware? If I'm planning a project for 2-3 years, should I procure all that hardware right away? When we mentioned above that, you know, cloud is scalable, cloud is elastic, so the hardware estimate does not play such a huge role because you can easily increase your capacity, be it processing power or be it storage on the cloud. Second thing is the hardware costs. All of us know that in a BI scenario, when we are executing ETL, there's a lot of memory that's taken up. Similarly, when we are processing, there's a lot of compute power that's taken up. Similarly, when we are processing cubes, again, a lot of memory is occupied. So, do we plan for that redundancy or do we just go with what is sufficient? Again, because the cloud is elastic, we have versions of the cloud in which you pay for what you use. So, when your ETL scenario is running, or because this is the month of March and all financial systems, IT computing systems are overburdened with tax calculations, in the month of March, you can ask for additional compute power and storage, and during the normal runs, you don't have to have anything. So, as I mentioned, the single most important thing of any solution or any application is to reduce cost and increase performance. When you don't have to worry about the hardware sizing, when you have to pay for only what you use, it shortens the implementation time overall without us being bogged down by the infrastructure. Hence, there's a lot of advantages in moving our BI solutions to the cloud. Now that we have agreed that we need to move BI to the cloud, let's see what are the three possible ways in which we can move BI to the cloud. There are three common methods. One is infrastructure as a service, IaaS, platform as a service, PaaS, and software as a service, SaaS. Let's see what these abbreviations stand for. When we are running anything on the premise, our application data, runtime, middleware, virtualization, we have to take care of everything. When we deal with infrastructure as a service, also called as hardware as a service, below anything below the operating system like virtualization, storage, networking is all taken care of by the service provider. So we install the OS, we install the runtime, we take care of the middleware and data and application. Alright? So we don't have to worry about networking and virtualization. When we use platform as a service, the operating system, the middleware and the runtime is all also managed by the service provider. For example, SQL Azure is offered as platform as a service. We have to only deal with application and data and pay for what we use. The third thing is software as a service, where, for example, like HD Insight, which is our big data story, Microsoft's big data story, you sign up and you start using it on day one. Office is another great example of software as a service. You don't have to worry about its maintenance, its upgrade, anything. You just have to sign in, pay for what you use, and it's readily available off the shelf. Now, all these three can be implemented in three different modes. You can either do it in public cloud, or you can do it in private cloud, or you can do it as a hybrid cloud. When we decide to do it as IaaS, you can deploy your own solution onto the cloud. Whatever virtual machine you have on the cloud, you can move it onto Azure. Now, our licenses are mobile, so if you have bought licenses which would run on-premise, it would also, you can also migrate it to the cloud. Okay? Now, the scaling of the architecture has to be done by you in particular, because you are dealing with everything on the cloud, so you are dealing, you move your entire infrastructure to the cloud, you have to take care of certain scaling here. When you start dealing with PaaS, which is platform as a service, you pay for what you use. It allows some customization, but not as much as in IaaS. In IaaS, you can have Unix virtual machines, you can run Python, Java, Perl, everything. But in platform as a service, you can run Microsoft technologies. Finally, when you start using software as a service, everything here is pre-packaged. You just have to sign up, pay for what you use, and go ahead. So the flexibility you have is less, because that should be available as a built-in feature. All these are available as public cloud. What are the other two variants? Private cloud and hybrid cloud. Private cloud is, if your organization owns and maintains a private cloud, you can design your own application on the cloud. It is slightly expensive as well. In hybrid, your data is on the private cloud, but when you have these spikes, like what we spoke about, the sudden impulse of the data for the maximum impact that you will have for data during any quarter end reporting, year end reporting, financial rush, calendar end is managed by the public cloud. So it's a combination of private and public. So to accomplish load balancing here is a slightly, it requires some skill in order to accomplish it. Now, let's recall this BI life cycle in order to see what were the challenges in doing real-time BI. What happens in a BI scenario? You've got different OLTP systems, ERP systems, database, HR databases, finance databases on different sources, Microsoft, IBM's DB2, Oracle, Teradata, SAP, and so on and so forth. You run ETL, which will extract the data from the source systems. You will do transformations such as, you know, convert from one currency to a uniform reporting currency, or you standardize dates, or you derive certain codes. For example, all my gender is going to be represented as M and F, never as 1 and 0. And you load the data. At the time, you also cleanse the data. If there are some fields which are compulsory and you do not have them in your system, then you say, no, these are all exceptions. Somebody will have to clean up with it. You also take care of standardization such as 2 decimal places, 3 decimal places, and schedule the run from the OLTP system into the data storage. Now, the difference between the data sources and the data storage is, the data storage generally is denormalized, because in a data warehousing scenario, we encourage redundancy. We also have aggregates. In an OLTP system, the data is mostly normalized and it is optimized for inserts, updates, and deletes. In a data warehouse, since the updates are all scheduled, there are what is more important is the reporting ability to query. From a data warehouse, in some scenarios, we also build data marts. So what is the difference between OLTP systems and data marts? In an OLTP system, the sources are different. Credit card system is different from HR systems, is different from employee database. Whereas when in a data mart, it is application, it is all subject oriented. So you deal with you know, employees, you deal with vendors, or you deal with customers. So it does not matter where the customer is coming from. He could have bought a single product, he could be a recurring customer, he could be a customer with the largest amount of product. You put all your customers together and you optimize them. When you then you build your memory cubes, you build your cubes. Traditionally, before SQL Server 2012, we had MOLAB cubes in which, you know, processing would pull the data from the OLTP system or from the warehouses or merge into the cube. And now from SQL Server 2012, we also have the tabular model. In the tabular model, the cube resides in memory. And then we build reports, graphs, dashboards, either from the mart or from the warehouse or from the cubes. Okay. So what exactly is the most difficult thing in this? Identifying what are the changes which have happened in the OLTP system and moving out into the warehouse. The transactions are easier to move because they are all based on date timestamp. But the dimensions are what are difficult. For example, let's say you have a database of 1,000 students. In that, some of the students may change their names for whatever reason. Some of them may have a wrong date of birth. They might want to correct it, and you will acquire new students. So what are the students who have undergone an SCD2 or an SCD3 and which are the new ones? In order to do this, we used complex stored procedures, we used date timestamps, and in SQL Server 2005, there were certain triggers introduced. After trigger, before trigger, insert trigger, you know, where we were escalated to have those triggers because to a large extent, it helped us identify the changes in the OLTP system and put it out into the data store. Nevertheless, all of them impacted the source OLTP system in a big way. Now, what is the change that, what is the new method that we have? We've got CDC or change data capture. Okay. It's a mechanism to trickle feed changes in data from a source database to multiple destinations in near real time. So how is CDC different from some of the trigger based approaches we had before? The trigger based approaches was an overhead on the source system, whereas here it is not, because it is log based. It will act not on the MDF files but on the LDF files, and it will propagate the changes. So let's actually see how to do this. Okay, here I have got my SQL Server database. I'm waiting for your screens to switch over to SQL Server database. I am going to create a new database here. I'm right clicking and saying new database. I will call this as TechGig Demo. Okay, I have got a database. Now I have got this query which will use the master to find out there is a table called sys databases. In that we have got a column called ECDC enabled. If you see, ECDC is enabled here for AdventureWorks DW, and that's the only database for which CDC is enabled. Okay, now how do we ensure that how do we start using CDC? Before that, I'd like to show you the TechGig database. If I expand the tables and the system tables, okay, similarly, if I go on to security, if I look at schemas, there is DB schema, DBO, guest information, and sys. These are the schemas which are available by default. If I take a look at the jobs, okay, whenever you are enabling CDC, make sure that the SQL Server agent is running. If I refresh the agent and take a look at the jobs, you will see that there are no jobs which have been created other than one single job called sys policy purge history. Now, what have we done? We've just created an empty database. We've not enabled anything on the database yet. What I will do is, I will create a simple table consisting of two columns. Okay, column 1 and column 2, I'm going to execute it. I'm going to change this database into the TechGig demo database and execute it. It says the commands executed successfully. Then I'm going to run a command called exec sys sp underscore cdc underscore enable db, and we will execute this. This is what will enable the database to become CDC enabled. Right? So now I have executed the stored procedure. Let's see what exactly the changes are. When I refresh and then take a look again at the system tables, I see that a set of CDC tables have been created. Okay, we'll execute and see we will actually see what each one of them will capture in a short while from now. Let's see what are the other tables. If we go back to the security and to the schemas, we will also see that even in the schema there is something called as CDC schema which has been created for this particular purpose. Now the question I have for you is, would you enable, if let's say there are 10 tables, would you want to capture changes on all the 10 tables? The answer is actually no. You will want to do it only on your dimension tables, because in your fact tables or in your transaction tables, it is easy to identify what the changes are, because they're all based on they are based on certain primary keys, they are based on timestamp. Whereas it is in test table 1, which we'll assume to be a dimension table, that we have to capture what it is. So what we will do is we will enable CDC on this table. Okay. Pay attention to the system tables. I am going to refresh my system tables again, and you will see that there are 6 system tables. Right? Now I am going to enable CDC on this particular table. I would also want you to pay attention to what is the message that we get. Generally it says message executed successfully, but in this particular case it will come back and say the jobs have been started successfully. So there are 2 jobs which have got started. One is called capture and the other is called cleanup. Okay. So in order to, that is why it was a prerequisite that you have to actually have the SQL Server agent running in order to do this. So I'm going to go back to my jobs here in the SQL Server agent and refresh this. You will see that there are 2 additional jobs which have been started. cdc.techgig_demo_capture and cdc.techgig_demo_cleanup. Okay. Now let's go back to the system tables and refresh the system tables to see what is the change that happened when we enabled CDC on a particular table. You can see that a new database called testTable1_CT, which is track changes, change track, has also been created. Okay. Now we created this table and it was all empty. I'm going to make some changes into the data on this one. I'll say column 1 is 1. Column 2 is Deepthi, which is what is my name. Column 2 is Raja N, who is a part of an implementation team of this. I'm going to say Sanjeev. These are all Microsoft employees who have been involved in creating this demo. Now, we will go to this change tracking table and do a select top 100 rows. So, you can see that there is a, what is LSN? It's the log sequence number or the logical sequence number. It says the operation type is 2 and the values entered are 1 Deepthi, 2 Raja M, 3 Sanjeev. Right? So let's actually make some changes into our table to see what is the operation type. I'm going to edit the top rows again and I'm going to change my name from Deepthi to Deepthi Anantaram, which is my name. Complete name. And then when I execute this and go back to see what has happened in the change tracking table, I will see that there are 2 new rows introduced. The 4th one is called Deepthi and the 5th row is called Deepthi Anantaram. If you look at the operation type, 3 means old value, 4 means new value. So it's capturing the old value and the new value, and 2 means all new values. 3 is the old value, 4 is the updated value of 3. Now, if I actually go and delete something, if I go and delete Sanjeev from here, you can see we've got 1. So operation type 1 stands for any value which has been deleted. Operation type 2 stands for any value which have been added newly. Operation type 3 and 4 go hand in hand. 3 will capture any change, Okay, 3 will capture all the old values and 4 will capture the updated value. Now, you don't have to look at any other table, logs or anything. The change tracking table is telling you exactly what are the changes that have happened and at what time sequence. Okay, did it actually say in this table at what time sequence? No, but it is giving you the start log sequence number. There was this another table here called LSN time mapping, right? So if I query this table, it's saying that this log started at this point in time and ended at this point in time. Okay, so combining these two tables, if you want to capture the changes which happened only between today 3:25:15 and between 18th minute and 19th minute, it is possible. We can capture only row number 3 to row number 7, right? Because we are using the tran begin time and the tran end time. Let's go back to this one now. So CDC has allowed you to identify what are the changes which have happened because it's automatically logging those changes for you in a separate table. How did we do it? Setting it up was simple. We queried to find out if the database was CDC enabled. If it was not, we enabled CDC on the table by executing a system short procedure. It created the CDC schema and the CDC system tables. And then we enabled it on a particular table. When we enabled it on a particular table, it created CDC jobs, okay, and it also created the CDC functions which I did not show it to you. But then it is the function which will help in identifying what are the old changes and what are the new changes. Now, there were these different tables. So the capture list of columns will say what are the columns on which we wanted to capture CDC. Why is this necessary? If you go back to the old version of how we did slowly changing dimensions, let's say we had an account dimension. The account dimension would have the account number, it would have the primary holder, it would have the account opening date, which would all never change. And if it changed for a reason, like if somebody died, then the account was inherited or continued by the secondary owner and so on. But the account balance now, you might argue that this is not a dimension value, dimension are all textual values and I wouldn't have it in my table. But in a real true warehouse kind of a scenario, you would also have the account balance on that table. And then because a lot of reports would say when it's asking for a account number, the most common question would be what is the account balance, right? So you wouldn't enable CDC to on a particular column. You would enable it on some set of columns which would actually cause a versioning of your primary information. Similarly, you would have a list of tables on which CDC is enabled. If you did any DDL changes after CDC is enabled, it will capture the DDL changes also. And then it indexes are locked separately, and then LSN. LSN will tell you what is the lock sequence number, what is the timestamp of when the change happened. Okay. So now, all good. We are able to capture real-time data changes. It is easy to percolate it. So the advantage would mean you wouldn't have to wait to move it in batches because you can trickle down your feeds in real-time. The question is, what if? What if the source was Oracle? The answer is, if any database has got a data file and a log file separately, then it is possible to do it. Let's actually take a look at this blog. Okay. It says that CDC for Oracle in SQL Server 2012 is absolutely possible. It works fine. You have to have the database set to archive log. Should have DBA privileges because you are going to look at the data miner. And then Identity Oracle CDC Designer is available. You can set it up and you can read these changes right from an Oracle database too. So even if it is Oracle, you have a solution. What will happen in if it's an Oracle database, like I mentioned, you should have the archive log set to true. You should have the privileges to lead the log miner. The log miner is a powerful tool in which you can do auditing of the system. And then you will run the SQL Server CDC service. The SQL Server CDC service will take these changes and put it onto a staging database. From the staging database, you run an SSIS package in order to push the changes to the final destination. What we would like to point out here is the final destination need not be SQL Server itself. That is, you need not have to move it from an Oracle source into a SQL Server warehouse. You can move it into a DB2, Oracle or PDW, Parallel Data Warehouse. What we're saying is, even if you have to move your changes from an Oracle OLTP to an Oracle warehouse, you can still use CDC. Why would you use CDC? Because implementation of CDC is so much simpler, it is faster. Right? So what are the different scenarios? What are the benefits that we have? First thing is, at a very granular level, you are able to understand what the changes are. As you saw, to enable CDC on a system, it took like 5 minutes, and for us to capture those changes and to understand how those changes are calculated. There is elimination of delay resulting from a data warehouse refresh in a batch cycle. This improved return on investments because of greater relevance, accuracy and completeness of information in real time. The business benefits are you have a decision making agility in real time. Okay. What we did was, as you see in box 4, Oracle on Azure, SQL Server on Azure, you can have the CDC also on Azure, whereas the other three scenarios are also equally true. You can have everything on premise. You can have Oracle on premise, your warehouse on premise, and run the CDC on premise. You can have either the OLTP system or the OLAP system on Azure, okay, on Azure or in Azure, and you can do the CDC also either on premise or inside the Azure. So irrespective of where you have your OLTP, where you have your OLAP system, you can run the CDC service either on premise or on the cloud. Okay, so you can do your Azure and your real-time changes really quickly. We have a case study which has been published by the Punjab National Bank. It is a bank which has got 119 years of strong experiences over and has over 6,000 branches. It services 82 million esteemed customers. So the issue we had was the end of the day bulk upload from their OLTP system to the warehouse took 6 hours. And bear it in mind here that the source was an OLTP Oracle system and the data warehouse was a DB2 system. The IT personnel had to work till midnight for the ETW to refresh and then send out reports. Now, using CDC, there's an up to the minute refresh of ETW, and it has reduced the labor cost that it would take, because initially 2 shifts of IT resources would run in order to deliver the resource. Here on my right, I have a list of people who have been involved in giving this elegant solution to Punjab National Bank. Let's look at what is a powerful new way to work with data. Right? I'm going to show you some Excel miracles. I'm going to open my Excel 2013. Blank Excel 2013. I go to my file, I go to my options, and then add-ins. In add-ins, I go to form add-ins and say go. If you have got SQL Server 2013 Professional and onwards, Power View, Power Query, Power Map and are all available, you just have to pick them. Okay. So what is Power BI? Power BI consists of 4 components. What are the things that you would like to do in a self-service BI kind of a scenario? First, you would like to get some information onto some processing tool. Once you have information from different resources, you would want to create some kind of a relationship between them. You would want to create some visualizations out of them, and you would want to create some dashboards out of them. Let's see if we can do all of them. So, the first thing that we have is Power Query. In Power Query, we can get data from different files such as Excel, CSV, XML, text, or from a different folder. We can get data from different databases. It need not only be SQL Server, you can also pull it from the cloud in terms of SQL Azure, from Oracle, IBM, MySQL, PostgreSQL, and Teradata. You can also get it from other sources like a SharePoint list, OData feed. You can also get data from Facebook, Exchange, Active Directory, and Windows Azure Blob Storage, and HD Insight as well. All these Of course, there are more and more adapters to different systems, but what is the most important thing here is the online search, right? This is new. So in an online search, you will get data from all the system that Microsoft decides that that is an authenticated source of data. For example, you will get data from Wikipedia, you will get data from any of the public.nic.in sites, you will get data from published from the Windows Azure blobs. Okay, you will get data from the marketplace. So let me run some query on to say India population. Now, if you see, I have got a set of results. One says religions of India. Okay, so this is based on the religions. How many are Hindus, Muslims, Christians? 6. Now, here there's one more population of India. It's by the states, Delhi, Haryana, so on and so forth. There's one more which says it is based on the age groups. Let me pick up the second one. Okay. Now, if I just double click on this and say load it on to the Excel. It will load the data onto Excel. What is important, what is good about this fact is, if you look at the source of this one, right, the source, it would be a Wikipedia page. If you go to that page, actually, you will see that it is not a table. It has got a lot of textual information as well. But the query is, when you execute the query, it is powerful enough to find out that I would want to get it only from these places. That is, it will read the HTML tags, it will identify the TRTD and pick up only the data information and put it onto Excel. Right? So this is a powerful new way in which you can get data into your systems. Let me close this. So this is the Power Query. Power Query will help you get data from different sources onto your Excel, including the online searches. Let me open Excel again. This time, let's assume that we've got all the relevant data that we need into Excel. How will we create relationships? I mean, how will I analyze if I've got multiple data? I'm going to go to my Power Query table. Sorry, I'm going to go to my Power Pivot table. I'm going to click on Manage. Okay, I'll get some data from SQL Server. I'm going to log into my SQL Server. I'm going to connect to our database and I'm going to get some data. It's giving me an option whether I want to get it from a list of tables and views, or I can write a query. That means I can write a join, I can do cross database joins, whatever. I'll now decide to get it from all the tables that are there. Okay. I can pick up one thing and then I can say select related tables based on the foreign key. Okay. It will pick up other tables. If there are no foreign keys, obviously it won't pick up anything. So I'm going to add everything. This database that I picked up has got 4 tables. One is the fact monthly sales, dim time, dim item, and dim geography, 3-dimension tables. I'm going to finish it. Now, this has only 532 rows, but even in like a million rows, because it's all happening in memory, it's extremely fast. There's a huge compression algorithm. There is no limit to the amount of data. I mean, the limit to the data that you can hold is very, very huge. On a Power BI site, you can hold data up to 6 GB on an Excel file, and that is when it is compressed by 3x. Okay, so this has an Excel look and feel. But if you look at this button in the corner, okay, you can get the diagrammatic view of it as well on your bottom right hand corner. If there were relationship within your system, it would have bought the relationship and it would have created keys. Otherwise, you can create the relationships by just dragging and dropping from here to here. Or you can also click on store ID, you can say create relationship. So it is saying that I have to create a relationship from fact monthly sales to store ID to, I'm going to select dim geography, and automatically it has picked up store ID because the names are similar. I can create a relationship. Similarly, for month ID, I'm going to create a relationship. Okay. Now, what next? Now that the relationships are created, I would want to create a hierarchy. What's a hierarchy? Generally, what happens in a cube? you would want to drill up and drill down. That is, you would want to go from your year to your quarter year to your month to your week to your day and so on and so forth. Similarly, drill up is or roll up is the same thing. You go from the lowermost level or the leaf level into the highermost level. You can also slice and dice across different dimensions in a cube. That is the basic advantage of using a cube. So let's say that I want to create a hierarchy. I'm going to create a hierarchy of my product. So at the topmost level, I have type name. I will click on the item name and say add to hierarchy, add to the product hierarchy, and then I can see that my product hierarchy has got two levels in it. Okay, I'm going to save this. I'm going to put it on my desktop as book 1, 2. I'm going to go back into my manage tab. Now what? Listen, whenever we clicked on the diagram view, there is also this small thing called as grid view. I'm going to go back to my grid view, where I can actually see the data in the form of tables and in the form of rows and columns, that is in the form of tables. Okay. I'm going to go on to this tab called the fact monthly sales. Let me create some measures. How did we create measures previously? Previously, whenever we created an MOLAP cube, there was a language called as multidimensional expression or MDX. We created cubes using MDX. So here I'm going to use, because it's an Excel, I'm going to use my Excel formulas. I'm going to create metrics just by using Excel formulas. Now, sum is something simple to do. What if I have to do something else, like a profit? What is the value of profit? I will say profit is equal to selling price minus cost price. Okay, now I will say I need to know what is my average profit, so I will still do an auto sum, but I will rename the metric to say average. How do we do it here in Excel? The moment I start typing to average, it gives it to me. I just click on this. So the average profit has been calculated. What next? What would we look for? Let's create a KPI. Okay. I'll say in terms of an absolute value, any profit now which is less than 100, okay, let's say which is less than 75, I want it to be red. Anything between 75 and 100, I want it to be yellow. And anything above 100, I want it to be green. Okay. Now, if I go to my pivot table and say I want a pivot chart, let me put it into an existing sheet. I will say I want to look at my selling price. I also want to take a look at my, I want to look at my selling price by my different city names. Okay. Now, okay. Then we had the product, right? So if I, there's something called an average profit. So I'll say show me the value of the average profit as a category. Remove the selling price for a minute. Yeah. So in this is the kind of graph that we get. Now things like let me create one more chart. If I want to say, give me the sum of selling price, the sum of cost price, give me the profit as a filter. So remove the average profit from here. Remove also the selling price to reduce the clutter. So if I say, show me all products which have got a profit of 363, I can see that only city one has got it. I can say show multiple things. I can click at random things here and say, oh, show me only these cities, right? And it is showing me city 1, 2 and 3. So it's allowed you to create these metrics. It's allowed you to create the KPIs, which are what are important. It's allowed you to create a hierarchy and relationship between the things. The advantage of Power Pivot is whatever you do here, you can write it onto a SQL Server Tabular Services model. In order to put it into a SQL Server Tabular Services model, you have another instance of SQL Server Analysis Services installed. You have to install it in the Tabular model and then write to it. Okay. Now this gave us the ability to add metrics. What if we had all the metrics? Can we create a dashboard? Let's actually create a dashboard now. I'm going to go back to my Excel and give you an example of what Power View can do. So I'm going to go into data. I'm going to import data, all right, from one of the existing connections of SQL Server where I get some data. When you have Power View installed, you will get this option to say Power View report, without which you wouldn't get it. I am going to put the data into a Power View report. If there are no relationships, you can create relationships as I did before. Now this is fetching all the data and storing it in a crunched format within Excel. What will I do? I will store all my distributors and I will store all the quantity that was served. Okay, I'm going to create a pie chart out of it. I'm going to click my cursor over here. I'm going to say, in terms of the items, give me the color of what was served and quantity consumed. And we will make it into a stacked column. Increase the size. I'm going to create a couple of more things. I'm going to say, give me the type of food that was sold and the quantity consumed. And then we'll do a stacked bar for this one. I'm going to increase its size. Then we are going to say, give me the type that was served and quantity consumed. And we will choose a line chart. Okay, let's put this also into a stack bar. Let's change this into a line. Because there are three data points, it will play around better. Let me give it a name. Let me call it as quantity consumed dashboard. Okay. Now, if I click on any of the distributor, it will change and say, this distributor, the curbside country, sold so many drinks, so many food, a lot of it as is, some of it cold, in these colors. It sold nothing as white. So who sold all the whites? It's saying that food which was white in color was sold very little as is, a lot of it was sold cold, a lot of it was sold hot, and by these people. So what did the field trip store serve? The field trip store served everything, most of it as is, very little hot, it served only food. So who served all the drinks? Look at the way there is dynamic play between these elements. Right? You can analyze anything that you want. In fact, if you can click on this pop-out, you can also click it out in terms of a pop-out. You can see the details if you have got a difficult chart to read with a lot of information, and you can push it back. When I click on this, there's also a filter which says show filter. So I can say not all colors, show me only brown, green, orange and red, right? Even in terms of the quantity consumed, here it's a dashboard. So let me just select everything. And then here I can say show me only, oops. Show me only what was served between this point and this point. Finally, the themes. If you don't like those colors, you can change everything to green from a bluish thing. You can change from green to, you can change it to something like red. Okay. Look at even the font of this header is changing. You can set an image. You can set a background color or you can set an image in the background. You can set up an image in the background if you would want it. Okay. So this is a live dashboard which we created in a few minutes. Look at the productivity that you're getting. All this is also a portion of O365. Let me show you the last portion of how we can enhance these visualizations, and we can enhance these visualizations from by using some 3D, by using representation of latitude and longitudinal information. I seem to have lost the folder, just give me a minute. Okay. Sorry. I've got some, what is important in this data is, let's understand this data a bit. I've got some case numbers, I've got some dates, then there is another number of what happened, okay? What happened in the thing, like, you know, this is related to heroin, this is related to cannabis, and where did it happen? Did it happen on the street, and did it happen on the sidewalk, and where beats happening in that area? What is the word number that it, in which it was happening, and what is the latitude and the longitude information? I'm going to go into my insert tab here and then click on map. So when I say launch Power Map, I'll create a new tour. It'll give me a brilliant, beautiful wizard to say what is my latitude and longitudinal information. Because it has got the same name, it will automatically pick up my latitude and longitude information. Let me tell you that you have to be connected onto an internet connection to do this, because it reads Bing Maps and gets information from there. Okay. So now, it's asking me, I'm going to click on next. It's asking me, what do you want for the height? I will say the number of beats for the heights, or I'll say probably the blocks, okay, because it looks a little more colorful. Then if I change, look at the dynamism with which it operates. If I choose the graph type as column, it'll ask me what is the height. If I change the column type to heat map, it's automatically created some color coding for me. If I change it to bubble, it's asking me what would you want the representation of the size to be, right? I mean, pretty intuitive that way. So I'm going back to my columns and I will say choose beats for the heights, choose blocks for the category, okay? And then there is something called the time. I'm going to drag and drop the date to here to say that it has to be time. When I do this, it's automatically given me this time button to play around with. When I click on the time button, it's saying that look at the way the things are doing. Now instead of this sum of beats, I can also say average or count of beats. If I run it again, because it is average, it won't change so much over time as the sum did. Okay, so this is again visualization in Excel. You can do a 2D chart, you can do a 3D chart, See, this will act as a filter now for you to find out what is happening. The background image will change based on what you have taken in the foreground. Alright, let's go back. What I wanted to show you is, in Excel, you can discover data using Power Query, you can analyze data using Power Pivot, you can visualize it using Power View and Power Map. The same thing is also available in O365 on the cloud. You can share it either on SharePoint or on a Power BI site. And then you can do Q&A as well, and you can finally deal with mobility. All these sites which are hosted can be seen as visualizations in a HTML5 browser, including your mobile devices. Okay, so we've spoken about Power Query, Power BI, Power View, and Power Map. There are some Power BI sites which I would recommend that you go and take a look at. So some of these Power BI sites, what you can do in terms of a Power BI site, if you click on it, you can go and say drill down to a particular customer level, age group, and it will work. It will fly. It will do it on the real time. Similarly, if you have got something like Olympic medal analysis, it will take a while because it's going to run from my SharePoint site. And then we have different analysis here by saying what is the medal which was won by sport, who was the top athlete. So, you know, in the year 1904, you can see that athletics was very popular, tennis was very little, boxing was somewhere here. So what happened a decade later in 2004? Athletics in Olympics are still very, very popular, but then aquatics is as popular as athletics. If you want to see who the top athletes are, you can see that in the Chinese Olympics in the year 2008, maximum medals were won by Michael Phelps. Okay. Similarly, who won it in basketball in the Chinese Olympics? It was won by this fellow, you know, Pondratix. Who won in the archery? It was Junjun Zhang. And who won it at the Greek Olympics? And it was Sunmyun Park. Right. Similarly, if you want to analyze the top countries by region who participated in Olympics, you get a bubble chart. If you want to take a look at women in Olympics, you can click on any event like athletics. What percentage was women? You can see that 31% was women. In shooting, the percentage comes down to 13%. Swimming, women are doing pretty well in swimming. It's 10%. And then, okay, football. It's almost negligible. I can't read. It's 3 out of 214. Okay. Similarly, cycling track is about 3%. You can see what was the ratio of men and women in different years. These all visualizations have been done and hosted onto a SharePoint site. You can do the kind of visualization we marked out, we did while we were doing the sample with the sample data, and push it onto your SharePoint site. If you look at the other dashboard that I saw, this is coming from a cloud app. It is hosted on the cloud. You can do a lot of, you can change the metric on the fly. The metric need not be discount quality. It could be transactions, and then it will apply to the whole dashboard over a period of time. Right. So I wanted to conclude by saying that not all business intelligence needs are the same. If they were, this world would be a very boring place. With Microsoft's BI offerings in Azure, you have the flexibility to create the BI environment that best fits your needs. Traditionally, SQL Server and SQL Server reporting services you can run off the cloud, and you can use Power BI and O365, including SharePoint, to create self-service BI. SSAS and SSIS are still not traditionally supported on the or available as platform as a service, but you can always put it inside a virtual machine and use hardware as a service in order to host it. Okay. Thank you very much. If you have any questions, we'll just take a look at them.
sending you some of the questions that we have received so far.
I can't see all of them.
I have sent you two so far.
Okay, one second.
I've sent you three questions and actually
yes.
Four queries so far I have sent.
Yeah. All right. Question by Sunny Kumar. What is the minimum system requirement you advise for using Power Pivot? We would not, I recommend about 8 MB, but then you can have more or less depending on how much of data you want to pull in. It slowed down the system my last time when I installed it, and also the startup time was higher. See, if you have about 8 GB of data, you will not have any issues. Again, it depends on how much you are pulling back. Okay. Some other links to get the examples, Shashank, what kind of examples would you want? Power BI, I mean, you can follow me on Twitter. The handle is at DEAANTH. I'm going to post quite a few links there on how you can get started with Power BI. How in-memory analytics of MS is advanced from SAP? See, these are all competing technologies, and even in SAP HANA, you have to load the entire database into memory. So the minimum that they would recommend is 256 GB. In-memory analytics, I refer to only the in-memory cubes, which is the tabular model, and since you are having everything in-memory, it's going to be that much faster. Apart from that, if you are referring to, you know, SQL Server 2014, where we can put the tables in memory, yes, you can. You have to recreate the tables in memory, and the entire table is going to be held in memory. So there is going to be more people who can access the things in memory, and it is going to be faster. Okay. Any other questions do we have?
Did you see all four questions that I sent you?
Yeah, I mean, Mukesh will have to clarify what is App Fabric component. I did not refer to an App Fabric component, but then yes, if it is something related to this, we could discuss it. Okay, I want to go for Project Daytona for Big Data Analytics. Please guide me. What should I go for? The Big Data solution that we have from the Microsoft stack is HD Insight. HD Insight, which is available on the cloud. If you want to do it on-premise, you can use Hortonworks Data Platform. So there again, you know, you can use any of the technologies that we have spoken about now, including Power BI or Cubes, which you can create. How should you get started with it? I mean, you'll have to sign up for HD Insight and then load your data onto it. You'll have to create some kind of a structure and then query. We've got one more question, which is, can we work with Office 2007 or Office 2010, the same features that what I showed today? With Office 2010, you have separate plugins. With Office 2013, they're all available inbuilt. You just have to enable them. With 2007, no, this is a very old version of Office in which this is not supported. For Big Data, we use Hadoop, right? Chalu, what it means is that, you know, Hadoop is the common name for Big Data solution, which is available in the open platform. Running Big Data solutions on the cloud using Microsoft Stack is called HD Insight. The advantages of using the Microsoft stack is that you can write your you can write queries using SQL. You can also create your MapReduce jobs using technologies like C#. You can integrate it with Active Directory, so the security is higher. And you can also use IT Pro stuff like, you know, like System Center and things like that in order to manage the databases better. Is write-back functionality available for Power BI? No, write-back is not available for Power BI yet. You could write back only into an MOLAP cube.
Okay. Yes, I think those were the questions, Deepthi, that we got today during the session.
All right.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
Thank you so much for the presentation. and I request all the attendees to post their queries on tegeek.com discussion forum. They can also write to you directly, and you can take the questions offline with each one of them. Also, today's recording.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Deepthi. Also, the recording of today's session will be available by tomorrow afternoon on tegeek.com. So, request you all to go and visit our site and go through the entire session once again. And thanks for your patience and fair support for making this webinar a success today. Thank you once again, Deepthi. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you all. Thank you.